today. Hello, everybody. This is Josh Price, and you are listening to the Mark Price for Three podcast. Each episode, my dad will be talking NBA basketball, sharing some coaching and instruction, and of course, talking about his faith. Without further delay, here's my dad, Mark Price.
Welcome back to the Mark Price for Three podcast, episode 46. It's a holiday weekend, so Mark and I are kind of putting together a different episode. For those that are regular listeners, we have not forgotten about stuff my coach said. We're going to do that episode, but we're giving you all another week to submit your thoughts and your stories of what coaches said. We've gotten a few so far, and they're pretty hysterical. So I can't wait for that episode, but it is a holiday weekend. Mark, how are you?
I'm doing great. How you doing, Eric?
Good. Did you all get a lot of rain from the hurricane?
A ton of rain. For about two nights straight, it was pretty heavy. So much needed rain, I would say. It was pretty hot here. So I kind of enjoyed getting a little rain, cooling it down just a little bit. But we're heading into Labor Day weekend. And I know we do mostly basketball on this podcast, but this is kind of the start of the college football season. A lot of games. Matter of fact, my alma mater plays tonight on a Friday night in Mercedes-Benz Arena downtown Atlanta.
Really?
So we'll see if Georgia Tech's going to be any good this year. Fingers crossed. Fingers crossed.
Is the team traditionally good, the football team?
It has not been lately.
Okay. That's fine. We'll leave it at that, because it is college football season, as you said. And so we wanted to get, I thought when I looked back at it, I said, you know, I've known each other maybe 2 years now. I don't know. And we've had a lot of conversations online, offline, and we've shared a lot of questions through the podcast. You've answered a lot of questions, but I still have more questions. So today I thought we would ask 20 questions and then finish with five of your favorite verses. That way we add up to 25, because it always has to come back to 25, right?
It does, man. It's the circle of life.
It's a circle. There you go. All right, let's start right at the beginning. Richfield Coliseum or Gund Arena, now called Rocket Mortgage?
Well, that's a pretty easy one for me, because I played 8 of my 9 years at Richfield Coliseum. Yeah. The first year used to be Gund Arena, which is Rocket Mortgage now. But I loved Richfield Coliseum. It was just, there was something special about it. It was out in the middle of nowhere. I know the other teams hated coming there, so it was a great home court advantage.
Yeah.
And I also lived in Hudson, Ohio, which was like a 10-minute drive down 303. Yeah. So it was a great setup, a great, great environment, especially early on. You know, it was a little weak just because of the history of the Cavs when we got there. But once we kind of got things going and started making the playoffs, I mean, that place was rocking.
Rocking. Yeah.
I hear an eating running at people today talking about the $10 nosebleed seats up in Richfield College.
Yep.
Bet you can't get one of those at Rocket Mortgage now. So it was a lot of fun, a great place to play. I love playing at Richfield.
There's something special. And as you said, I think the purists, the traditionalists, we all in Cleveland understood why they moved downtown. To your point, it was a longer drive, blah, blah, blah. But I think the purists remember that the Richfield Coliseum was special. It really was. Like we talked about in our previous episodes, like an old school gym, you know, for a college. Something special about Richfield. All right. We got a lot of questions to get through. So let me, favorite arena you ever played in? And was there a court where you walked on that court and it just, you knew you were going to have a good night?
Well, most of the time I had good nights.
Yeah, you had a lot of those.
And would have to be Boston Garden for me.
Really?
All the fabled fame arenas, you know, whether it be the Forum in LA, you know, old Chicago Stadium, all the, especially on the East Coast, all the older kind of arenas. But there was just something, man. There was, whether it was a million banners hanging up in Boston Garden, the open air. I mean, a lot of people don't realize the old Boston Garden was kind of open air.
Really?
The outside. I mean, winter, it was freezing in there. You'd go in for shoot around and you literally are bundled up just trying to, and then as the people got into the arena, you know, it warmed up and things like that. But there were spots on the floor that the ball wouldn't bounce. And, you know, especially DJ, Dennis Johnson early on, he's funneling you this one way. And you're thinking, why is he funneling me that way? And all of a sudden the ball doesn't bounce up, you know, when you're dribbling. And so it was just a great place. And also it was just a shooter's gym, man. For me, it just felt like the rims were just twice as big as any other arena. I had many good shooting nights at Boston Garden. I love playing there. And the fans were so passionate too about their teams. It made it fun as well.
So interesting. I never knew that. If you could pick four Cavaliers to play with, name your squad. Obviously you're the point guard.
Well, I'm biased to the team that I played with. I'd probably pick three of those guys to go, you know, Ron Harper at two guard, Larry Nance at power forward, Brad Doherty at center. And I think you could probably slip LeBron James in there, small forward, you know, for sure.
That's a good pick.
But, you know, going back to that team, I think if we don't trade Ron Harper, I still believe that we win a championship with that team. I really feel like we were that close and we were that good. But, you know, there was always great. You could slip Austin Carr in there at the two spot. I mean, great, great player in Cavs history. You know, a lot of great players over the years. But those would probably, that would probably be my group.
Can you imagine that squad? The missing hole, you could correct me if I'm wrong. The missing hole for you guys was always small forward. And no disrespect to the small forwards you had. It just always felt like they were out looking for a small forward, trying to fill that one last spot. Can you imagine if 23 was your small forward?
Because back in those days, too, it was the three position was the scoring position.
Right.
But if you go through the league, I mean, whether it be Larry Bird playing three or Dominique Wilkins with the, I mean, that three position was just dynamic during the 80s and 90s. The two position and the three position were considered your scoring positions back in that era. And I mean, you had Adrian Dantley over it, you know, Detroit. I mean, you just go down the list and it was just like score after score at that position. And we never had that when I was playing with the Cavs. We didn't need it necessarily because we had so much scoring in other positions. But the small forward position was like a revolving door while we were there. You had to be Weston Bennett or Tyrone Corbin or constantly finding guys that Mike Sanders, you know, guys that were very good players, you know, that had to face the Giants every time we played. It was amazing.
Randolph Keys, Henry James are just a few other names that came to mind. Like you said, it was a revolving door. They were constantly trying to fill that one last spot, but been pretty cool if 23 could have filled. He came a few years later. So now we've talked about the team. What coach? Your college, high school, NBA, what coach would you say that's the guy I want on the sidelines for my squad of five that you just mentioned?
Well, for the NBA, you know, that squad, obviously Lenny Wilkins was such a great coach. For me, particularly when I came into the league, he was, you know, Hall of Famer, point guard, played my position. Just had so much wisdom to pass along to me because I came out, we've talked about this before, but I came out of Georgia Tech, kind of a shooting guard in a point guard's body. I mean, I was kind of a shoot first type guy, which was unusual for the NBA at that time. I mean, the only two scoring point guards you have in the league that time were Isaiah Thomas and Magic Johnson. Mm-hmm. And I remember, I think that my second year when I earned the starting spot, I think I was the third highest leading scorer from the point guard position. And so you just didn't see that a lot. So a lot of people, I think, might've passed on me coming into the NBA because they didn't really think I was maybe a point guard necessarily. And I was too small, obviously, to be a two guard in the league. But Lenny Wilkins and Wayne Embert, to their credit, they looked at that as an advantage. Mm-hmm. Like, I think Lenny was kind of, I think I haven't heard him say one time, you know, I could teach Mark the other things, but I couldn't teach him to shoot like that, you know? So like he saw that as a weapon, as a real advantage that I had, that he could kind of add the other stuff too, that allowed me to become a, you know, perennial all-star point guard in the league.
What a fantastic coach to start your career with. Honestly, that a legend in Cleveland, for sure. Next one, what is the worst road trip with a team that you've ever been on?
I would say the worst road trip was probably my rookie year. And I think we've shared this story as well before, but when I first got to Cleveland, we would play like two home games when the season started, and then the circus would come to town.
That's right. Oh, Ringling Brothers.
Literal circus would come to town and kick us out of the arena. And they would have a circus in the arena for like 2 weeks.
Yeah.
So they would send us out to the West Coast. I remember we played two home games, and then we went on an 8-game, 15-day West Coast trip. And that's when we were flying commercial and everything else. And so it was just an absolute, I mean, that 2 weeks felt like 2 months.
Yeah.
And I think we might have gotten the last game on that road trip. I think we might have gotten by 40. We were just so like.
Just done.
We were done and ready to get home. And it was brutal. It was brutal. And we had five, six rookies on that team that year. So talk about a brutal trip for guys, a wake up call to, hey, welcome to the NBA traveling. Right. That was something else.
It's funny because my next question, you might've just answered it, was what was the moment your rookie year when you realized this isn't college anymore? This is the big time.
Just the turnaround, the quick, I mean, in college you played 30 games max for the whole season. So you're getting like 3-4 days in between every game. Sometimes even longer than that. And I mean, you know, on those kind of deals, you're playing sometimes 4 games in 5 nights, 5 games in 7 days. Just the recovery time and learning how to, you know, protect your body, keep your body fresh, being able to come out and play again the next night, I think was a real wake up call that, hey, this is not college. And so that's the biggest, I think, learning curve for guys coming from college to the NBA. It's not talent level. It's not, you know, what you can do. It's how do you manage the number of games and being able to get yourself ready to play night in and night out.
So that wall that they talk about people hitting is real.
No doubt. Yeah. No doubt. I mean, literally by All-Star break, you've already played about 10 more games than a college season. You still have a whole number 40 something more games to play. And like you're playing almost 3 seasons in one. I mean 3 college seasons in one season, because you talk about 8 preseason games. If you make any playoff games, you know, any significant playoff games, you're talking about 100 games in a season. So you're going from 30 games to 100. It's just, you know, it's kind of mind boggling, you know, when you think about it. And it can be overwhelming. Best in your first year through it.
And you didn't have the science and the nutrition and all the other things that guys today have. What's your game day ritual? Was there a nap involved? Did you eat pasta? Like, what was your game day ritual, both college and NBA?
Yeah, for most of my career, whatever, and you'd go to shoot around, come home, take a nap. I had to take a nap. And my wife, bless her heart, you know, after we start having kids and everything else, I mean, she had to monitor, either get everybody out of the house for an hour or, you know, make sure everybody was quiet for an hour so dad could get a nap, you know, in order to function for the game. And then about, you know, 3:30, 4 o'clock, I'd eat a big bowl of spaghetti and meat sauce and take off, head to the arena, get ready to play. But not complicated routine, but that was pretty consistent all the way through for me. Yeah. That was my go-to.
Okay. You're on the plane or a bus or whatever. So our day, it was cassettes. So you probably had your Sony Walkman on. What are 5 cassette tapes or CDs that you're bringing with you on the road trip?
You know, I didn't do much of that, you know, headphone, listen to stuff. I was, you know, doing other things, you know, on road trip. We're on a plane. We actually have guides that we would play cards or we'd play chess. You know, Danny Ferry and I had a chess match going on, you know, when we travel. You know, when I got to Orlando, my last year I played, there's a couple guys, Bo Outlaw, a couple other guys that I was playing with, and we would play Monopoly. We called it Speed Monopoly. Like we've gotten it down to where you could play a Monopoly game in an hour flight. You know, it's kind of like I had to buy everything and make trades, and then whoever, you know, it's just like, you know, it was crazy. But yeah, and I was a little bit more in the interactive stuff rather than just say, let's put the headphones on and let's go to sleep. Yeah. You know, on every flight. I never was much of a sleeper on planes. I had my sleep done in the room or, you know, when we got there. But I know a lot of guys, man, as soon as they hit the seat, they were knocked out. Oh. So everybody kind of had their own thing, but yeah, that was kind of my approach to travel.
You've told the story before. You met Dr. J for the first time in chapel. It's an amazing story. One of my favorite stories that you've told me. Was there any other players? Were there any other moments when you were starstruck your rookie season? Like, wow, I'm here and I'm playing against whoever it might be. I know, I'm sure for a lot of players now, it's Mike, you know, LeBron James or it's Kobe or Michael or whatever. You know, you played against Michael and with Michael multiple times. So that's not a guy that probably would, most people would be like, oh, it's Michael Jordan. Was there somebody else that you just were like, wow, I can't believe I'm on this stage with playing against this person?
Yeah, I think that the big names, it was just so cool. I mean, I was such a basketball fan. And it's, you know, Larry Nance, even when he got traded, like, because my dad, I had a history with Phoenix because my dad had been an assistant coach with the Suns for a couple of years when I was like 10 years old. So I was always, ever since that time, I was always kind of a Phoenix Suns fan. And I remember when I was in college watching Larry Nance, Phoenix. He was such a high flyer, winning slam dunk contest. He was one of my favorite players.
Yes.
After Cleveland, you know, I was starting to make all-star teams and things like that. By the time Larry got there, he still doesn't believe me to this day, but I was so pumped. You're like my favorite player, man. Now I get to play with you.
Yeah.
It's stupid or whatever, but you know, it's like, it really was cool for me to, I got to play, you know, with Larry Nance, and that was such a highlight. But you know, I came into the league, Dr. J was his last season, got to meet him at, you know, chapel. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar was on his, you know, end of his career. Just so many of their all-time greats, you know, Larry Bird, the Magic Johnson. I mean, that whole Lakers team, you know, was unreal. So it's just like, there was that fine line between, yeah, I was awe, but then I was such a competitor.
Yeah.
Like, as soon as I hit the court, man, I was like, I wanted to beat those dudes, you know? Mm-hmm. It was like, it kind of, something changed when I hit the floor, but off the court, I was still in awe that I'm beating these guys because they were just some of the greatest players that's ever put on shoes, right? Mm-hmm. And I'm out there on the court, like doing battle with them. It was just like an amazing experience, an amazing time. And that's, you know, there were just so many during that era that I got to play against. And yeah, I was in awe getting a chance to see them and watching them meet on there. But I was also in awe that I was getting to an opportunity to compete and try to beat those guys that I'd watched for so many years.
And I was going to ask that question. I think you answered it. So the minute the ball was tipped, the awe was over and now it's game on.
Essentially. Okay, we're the good guys. You're the bad guys now, man. We're trying to beat you. So yes. So it was still pretty cool, even, you know, because, you know, the guy was during the game, little things would happen. And I think even just things that they would say, there was a sense there, you know, at the beginning, they didn't know who you were and how that changed to kind of like a mutual respect.
Yeah.
Once you kind of lit them up a couple of times or, you know, showed that you belong.
Yeah.
It was like all of a sudden you were just treated differently by those guys. If that makes sense.
No, it does. Absolutely.
It goes from, hey, this dude's a, you know, got backup point guard coming in, rookie year guy, you know, kid from Georgia Tech, they might have heard whatever, but to, okay, we got a game plan for this dude. You know, I mean, this dude can make it happen. So there's a point where that kind of changes to, you know, they're up here, you're down here, to where you're kind of like, you know, you put yourself on the same playing field.
And that happens on asphalt courts. It happens in high school gyms. It happens in rec centers and pickup games everywhere. That's the beauty of basketball, is you walk in and nobody knows you. You know, you're going to have to fight to get on a team. But once you show it, and it, you know, especially if you play all day or you go back every Saturday to play, whatever it might be, they know. You know, it's not like they're game planning in the locker room because it's a you know, outdoor court, but they know, and they know how to, they start to pick apart your game and know that you can't shoot, or, you know, not a very good, he's got no left, or, you know what I'm saying? So that's the beauty of basketball. So it's interesting that it happens all the way up to the NBA.
It really does. And it's kind of cool to watch that progression happen. You know, like some kind of nobody to all-star player or whatever, and how you're looked at amongst your peers.
And I know you well enough to know you're humble enough that you probably never thought of it this way, but at some point you became the awe player for somebody else. Like guys coming in the league, yeah, looked at you and said, man, I get to play against Mark Price. I mean, think about that. That's kind of cool.
Yeah, to your point, it was, you know, when Steve Nash first came into the league,
yeah,
you know, kid from Canada, he played at Santa Clara. And I remember we were playing in world championships in Toronto in 94, and he was playing with Canada, and we had one of these kind of deals where a lot of the teams had some of their players there. And I remember Steve coming up to me at that time. I had heard his name from college, but he was at Santa Clara. It wasn't like it was coming from a big name program or anything like that. And he kind of came up to me and basically told me I was one of the guys that he tried to pattern his game after, and that kind of deal. So yeah, it's kind of cool when you become kind of the guy that people look up to. So yeah, you're exactly right on that.
Yeah. I used to run to Ron Harper at Shawnee Hills over near Bedford in my home. And I'd see him out. You'd see him at Randall Park Mall. Like Ron was all over town. You'd see him, you know, after a while, I was just like, oh, there's Ron Harper again. But you know, I ran to Larry Nance at a mall one time on Christmas. We were shopping. Where was your spot? Where'd you go? Or did you just completely avoid going out?
You know, we were out and about the community. We lived in Hudson. And so I love the little town that we lived in there. So especially around that community, people would see us at the grocery store and movie theater or whatever it would be. And, you know, pretty much leave us alone for the most part, you know, and with respect and things like that. But yeah, it got to be a point at times, you know, when you become so well known, and I played there for 9 years. And so we didn't, you know, sometimes we didn't like to get out as much as we did, you know, when we were younger, but just didn't want to, you know, mess with all that, you know, have to sign 1 million autographs for this whenever we go somewhere. But yeah, for the most part, we were very active over the years in the community. We went to the chapel in Akron. It was the church we went there. So we had so many friends there as well. And just, you know, it was just a part of the community. And I think, you know, we've talked about it before. I think that was one of the reasons that the fans in Cleveland connected so much with our team, is that we were one of them, you know, that were just normal guys out and about the community, raising our families. You know, we just happened to put on a uniform, you know, 82 games a year to go out, you know, play basketball was the only difference. And they got to watch us on TV. So,
yeah.
But I think there was that connection, is because we were involved in the community. We were part of the community and loved being part of the community.
Autographs, I know, not a brag, I got the chance to work for the great Bo Jackson. And I know Bo, he's got an opinion about autographs and his signature on items and how and when and why he will do them. You mentioned doing a lot of autographs, and I understand that from his perspective, because people will turn around and make money off of his name, you know? So I just wanted to ask you that. I think you're pretty, you know, fair about autographs, but when you look at autographs, have you ever been like, man, that's, You know, I mean, it is terrible that people turn around and make money off of it and make it their own business. For me, getting your autograph as a fan, that was a moment for me. I never could have even imagined selling it. What's your thought on all that?
Yeah, it's, I think it's like anything. I mean, there's, I would say 90% of it is good. Mm-hmm. A young kid wants you to sign his cap, or
yeah,
got his jersey on, wants you to sign it. I mean, those are things you like to do. You know, when you get a letter in the mail and it has 25 cards that they're wanting you to sign, that's just the toes. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, just, I do.
Know that that's for money.
Yeah.
Make and things like that. So anytime I get a sense that it's a fan and they, you know, and especially kids.
Yeah.
That's why I love doing my camps, and I have a part of my camp where, you know, I let them bring things they want me to sign, because it's for them, it's for the kids, and I enjoy that, and I love connecting with them that way. But yeah, there's always a side to things that you wish wasn't there, that you just have to deal with the best you can.
Next up, in college, you were featured in Sports Illustrated on the cover because you guys were preseason number one, I think. But then also the article that I remember that you and I've talked about before, there was an article called Opposite Side of the Tracks or something like that, you and Bruce Dalrymple. And I remember it vividly. I remember reading the article. I remember seeing pictures of you singing with your family on a church platform. I'm like, man, that guy, it's like the church I grew up in, singing on the platform. It was a great article. What was it like in college being featured in something like Sports Illustrated?
That was probably one of the coolest things ever. Because, you know, you have to go back to the day, right? There wasn't internet. There wasn't all the
ESPN.
So these magazines were how people, and Sports Illustrated was the magazine, right?
Right.
Had a bunch of them. You had Sport Magazine. You had, I think we were going into my senior year in college, we were probably on five or six different covers of these basketball magazines. But Sports Illustrated was, you know, that was the one. And for them to want to do an article on, you know, and they really came up with a cool concept, because Bruce was from New York and I was from Oklahoma. We were the best backcourt in the country. And it kind of talked about the differences in our upbringing. And, you know, it was Opposite Sides of the Track was one of the coolest, I think, you know, ways to phrase it and things like that. As a matter of fact, showing me on a railroad track and
spinning the ball. Yeah.
Right. So it was super cool. And they flew us into like New York City to do the cover shot of that with Cheryl Miller.
I thought it was Cheryl Miller.
And they brought all three of us to New York to do that. And it just, you know, that was just kind of as I was, people kind of finding out about me, I guess, and how good we were at Georgia Tech. Kind of making a name for ourselves, but that was kind of a big splash. And in some ways it was really, really cool. But then all of a sudden it was a little bit of pressure after that, right? You get put on Sports Illustrated and now you're like looked at differently. Like everybody off, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Everybody off the perch, so to speak. So but yeah, a really cool article. Listeners are out there, man. If you could find that, I mean, it was pretty cool. It was a really cool article.
It was a great article. And that's when I think first, to your point, there wasn't Twitter, there wasn't social media, there wasn't ESPN, there was maybe CNN had a top 10, but most of us didn't have cable unless you could, you know, you were rich and you could afford it. You just didn't know. You read it in the newspaper or Sports Illustrated. So when that Sports Illustrated hit, Sports Illustrated and East Bay were the two biggest things to come in the mail, the East Bay magazine with the new kicks in them. Most people probably have no idea what we're talking about right now, but the East Bay catalog was always amazing. You mentioned college. You played with John Sally. So and John Sally was a part of the Bad Boys, a big part of the Bad Boys. Did you ever discuss it? Like, how hard was that when your former teammate, a guy you trusted, you know, you went to war with every single day in college, is now on the team that there was a lot of hatred between those two teams. Was that ever weird?
Yeah, it was never really weird between John and me. We played four years together at Tech and, you know, knew each other well. John was never of all the bad boy guys. John played physical and he played his part, but he wasn't trying to intentionally hurt anybody.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't, you know, you get to Lambeer and Horn and some of those other guys, you know, maybe that's a different story or whatever, but yeah, we never really talked about it, you know, other than, you know, he would say every time about him, he'd like, man, Isaiah doesn't, you know, he wants Joe to have to guard you or whatever, man. You know, it's like, you know, and things like that and stuff. But yeah, we never really tried to kind of talk about that kind of thing. It was what it was. And he happened to be on their team. And I was on the Gabs. So, you know, I'm sure he probably told them to try to get physical with me, but everybody, that was everybody's.
That was the book.
That was everybody's plan to try to slow me down. Yeah. Probably, I suppose they could.
Well, it didn't work. So, all right, I'm going to hit you with rapid fire. We got to move quick. Number 15, best shoe you ever wore?
Best shoe. I would say there was a Converse. We were wearing Converse the year we won the ACC championship. And still, I love that shoe. So,
yeah. Okay. Long shorts or short shorts? Because honestly, when you first came in the league, they were pretty short. I mean, they were pretty short, but then they got ridiculously long. Did you have a preference one way or the other?
I was probably right kind of in the middle there somewhat. My shorts at college at Georgia Tech, I mean, I pull them out and literally it's like obnoxious. It's like offensive if I were those things. Put those things on now. I actually like ran around in front of people like that. I mean, it's like mercy. That would have been, you know, that was crazy. But yeah, I got a little bit, you know, a little bit longer. Of course, I think it was Michigan Fab Five.
That's right. Broke the mold.
I never wore them over the knees or anything like that. I just weren't comfortable that way. But yeah, somewhere there was a happy medium in there for me and with the shorts and, you know, I kind of stayed consistent most of the way through, you know, as I got to a point where I was comfortable with them.
There you go. Okay. Great shooters are born or made.
Well, this is what I believe. I believe everybody can become a better shooter. I think you can improve your shooting, but great shooters, I think they just have something different. Yeah. I don't think you can become a great shooter. I think you're made. I mean, now the great shooters have all put the time in and put the work in as well, but they just have that something that allows them to be a little bit better than everybody else. And I don't know that there's part of that that can't be taught.
Okay. You can throw an alley-oop to any player, all time, teammate or otherwise, past or present, who you throwing the alley-oop to?
Larry Nance, baby.
Oh. Is that right? That was easy. There was not even a hesitation.
Oh. You see, if you especially, I got to play with Larry as he kind of was on the back end after some whatever, but if you'll go watch some Phoenix Suns, I mean, that dude.
He could go get it.
He was catching it at the top of the backboard type stuff. Yeah. So
even on a bad one, even when you just knew, let me throw it somewhere up there and Larry's got it.
And he would say that. He would go, man, just throw it. I'll go get it. So.
Okay. Best Cavs logo, past or present. This is going to put you on the spot a little bit.
Best Cavs logo. That's a tough one. When you say logo, are you talking?
I'm talking like, so you had the original with you guys with the V with the ball, and then you had the lightning thing for a while, and then now they've got throwbacks and they got swords, and I actually kind of like where they're at right now, but did you have a favorite?
Yeah, well, I loved you know, when they went to the orange and blue and those blue road uniforms with the, you know, Cavs with the kind of, you know, which one I'm
talking. Yeah.
You know, I've been like that, the one that said Cleveland across there as much as just the Cavs with the kind of basketball hoop kind of thing.
Yeah.
That was probably my favorite.
I'm glad they brought that back. I'm wearing the hoodie right now. I'm glad they kind of brought back that throwback kind of thing. All right. Greatest NBA memory. This is your last question. Greatest NBA memory.
You know, that one's tough because I just have so many great memories, you know, individually getting a chance to play on four all-star teams, represent the United States, you know, on Dream Team 2, you know, knocking Larry Bird out, you know, in the Eastern Conference semifinals, get to the conference finals. So many great, great memories and just epic, like got to be a part of so many like epic games and things like that. And even the shot, you know, which is a negative being in the Cleveland history. But I mean, that game was just epic.
Amazing.
You take away the last piece there, but the whole game was just epic. And, to be a part of games like that, you know, it was just so cool. And just memories I'll never forget.
Amazing. Well, you've been gracious with a lot of questions there. I'm going to ask you because we got to finish it out with five things. You know, now we get to 25. What are your five favorite verses?
Yeah, for many, many years when I was growing up, my go-to verse was Psalm 27:1. And I would share that a lot. A lot of it was just what I had to go through to get to where I went through. And it, you know, Psalm 27:1 was just that talking about that you're not afraid of anything, basically. God is with you, you know, and the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be afraid? And, you know, it's just, I relied on that verse so much growing up, like, because I was small and having to go into situations that were bigger than what I physically even probably belonged in a lot of ways. But I had no fear because, I mean, the Lord was my light and my salvation, and he had my back. We talked about Ephesians 3:20 before, you know, that God is able to do exceeding abundantly beyond all that we ask or think. That he had a plan for me that was far greater than I could have ever imagined for myself.
Yeah.
That's been my life verse for many years. There's a verse in 1 Peter 5:6 about humility. It says, humble yourself, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time. So the humility of just staying faithful, being patient, doing the work. And when it's time, God's going to lift you up. He's going to exalt you at the proper time. And that's a verse I've always come to. The next verse is one that's familiar to so many people, but John 3:16 still is just amazing. You know, God so loved the world, but he gave his only son. You know, that whosoever should believe in him will not perish and have everlasting life. You know, that's the gospel, you know, that you and I that hold dear to, that he loved us so much that he sent his own son to die for our sins. And then my last one would be probably Romans 1:16. Most the apostle Paul was out in the margins, and basically, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It's the power of salvation. And so that's another verse that over the years, it's like, and you're going to be in the midst of it. Hey, you may not be in the popular one. You may not be taking the popular path, but man, I'm not ashamed. I'm not ashamed of my relationship with Christ and what he's done for me in my life. And I'm going to walk, and I'm going to walk as faithfully as I can with his help to live a life that honors him the best I know how. So in a nutshell, those would probably be five of the big ones for me.
Well, that's a great starting five. And I would tell you, there's a phrase that always says, if you were on trial for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? And knowing what I know about you, there's plenty of evidence more. you're going to be convicted of being a Christian because the way you live your life, back to what you just said about that verse, I've seen nothing in your life that tells me otherwise. And that's a pretty high compliment in a world where we can be easily swayed and pulled into a lot of other things. I just want to honor you that way by saying that. The other thing I would say is we're coming up on episode 50. So this was probably a good chance for people that maybe are jumping in late to here's some things they never knew about you. So thanks for taking time today to walk us through those things.
Oh, yeah. No, it was fun. It was fun to answer some of those questions. Maybe have answered a few questions that other people that listen to the podcast might have asked if given the chance. So it's been another good episode. I always enjoy spending time and talking about ball and talking about faith and getting a chance to share some of my stories this week. It was really cool.
That's awesome. All right. Get your things my coach told me to us. Put it on social media. Email me, aaron@aaronconrad.com, if you would like. Send us your things or on there's some stuff on Facebook as well. Leave us your comments. We want to hear things that your coach would say to you. Mark, thanks. Hope you have a great weekend.
All right, Aaron. See you next week.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Mark Price for Three podcast. Remember to subscribe, like, review, and share. I'm Josh Price, and we will talk to you again on the next episode. So keep